ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। ओ श्री रामकृष्ण, द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलिजन्स, द एस्टैब्लिशर ऑफ द इटर्नल रिलिजन एंड द बेस्ट ऑफ ऑल इनकॉर्नेशंस, वी सैल्यूट दी। Today is the holy day of the birthday of Swami Abhedananda ji, one of the monastic disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. We all know Sri Ramakrishna, the incarnation of this age, had 16 monastic disciples to start. And these 16 are the direct disciples and apostles of Sri Ramakrishna, and one of them was Swami Abhedananda. He was unique in many respects. Abhedananda, in his pre-monastic days, he was called the Kali Prasad Chandra. Chandra was the title, Kali Prasad was his name. His father had 11 children, and he was from the second wife. His father was Rasiklal Chandra and mother was Nayantara Chandra. It is recorded that this child was born in a pose which was almost like a yogic pose, and significantly he did not weep at all, which usually a newborn child does, and they had to put some hot powder into his eyes to make him weep. So weeping is required to take in the breath, to start the breathing. So it was to be done artificially, because he was a yogi, he didn't want to breathe and then get entangled into his world. Then when he grew up, he was a very precautious boy and was very good in studies. In his school life, he used to take much interest in Sanskrit studies. As a young boy of 10 years, he had read some of the standard books in Sanskrit like Hitopadesha and Kalidasa's works and Bhatti, another great poet like Kalidasa, his works. So he was interested in Sanskritic studies. Later on we find he becomes one of the great scholarly persons in our mission, and especially among the direct disciples, he was one of those who knew Sanskrit very well and could speak, argue, and many times defeat his opponents also in logic, Sanskrit logic. So he was in the high school. And during that time, he went to gymnasium to learn gymnastics. So he spent some time in building up his body. That was the need of the age. All the young people of his time, it was the national liberation movement going on. All the young people had to keep their body fit to fight the foreign rule that was raging in our country. So he also went to a gymnasium and built up his body's health. But unfortunately, he didn't continue long, because his misread Herbert Spencer's writing on education, where Herbert Spencer said that brains cannot develop along with brawn, along with the muscles. You cannot develop muscles along with good brains. That was a wrong conception of Herbert Spencer, which Swami Vivekananda disproved. In his own, one of the strongest men and one of the most intellectuals of the world. So Swamiji disproved Herbert Spencer. So this young man, after reading Herbert Spencer, he gave up the gymnasium. Similarly, he read Wilson's History of India, where he had praised Shankaracharya as a philosopher and saint also. Then Swami Kali Prasad, he said, he will be my ideal. I will also be a philosopher and also a saint. So these young impressions, you see how nice impressions he has. Then he joined a painting class and he gave up that painting class, saying that painter only looks at the outer form only, whereas philosopher looks deep into the personality of persons. Therefore, I would rather spend this time in philosophy than going for this painting class. So he gave the painting class. So at 14 years, he wanted to read Bhagavad Gita. His father had one Bhagavad Gita copy in his room. So he didn't want his young boy to read Bhagavad Gita and develop a philosophical outlook on life. Because in those times, that is the 19th century end, so they did not want their children to be philosophers. They wanted them to be followers of the British and become big officers, IAS, or at that time it's called ICS officers and all that. So he had hidden that book, his father, in a very one corner of his almira. But this boy wanted to read it. So when father has gone to bed, he would go stealthily into his room, take out that book, read the Bhagavad Gita in the midnight, and keep it back before father could notice that it had been taken out. That is how he read Bhagavad Gita and was very much well versed in it later on. Then he attended the lecture of one famous speaker on Hindu religion, Shashadhar Tarka Chudamani. He referred to yoga and yoga sutras of Patanjali. This young man wanted to learn yoga sutras of Patanjali. Who will teach him? Then he asked the Shashadhar Tarka Chudamani himself, whom he could approach. Then Shashadhar sends him to Kalibar Vedanta Vagish, who was supposed to be a learned man in this yoga sutras. This 16-year-old boy went to him and then learnt with great difficulty. The Kalibar Vedanta Vagish said, I have no time to teach you, but only one time I can give you is, see, I smear oil on my body. Before I take bath, I smear the oil on my body and then go for bath. That may take 15 to 20 minutes. You do that work. When you are doing it, I will teach you the yoga sutras. The boy agreed. He was so much interested. So he served Kalibar Vedanta Vagish. Simultaneously, he learnt also yoga sutras. That was the tremendous interest he had in yoga sutras. We see the reason for that one. Then, somewhere in 1882, he was just 16-year-old, his friend, one Yajneshwar, suggested, why don't you meet Sri Ramakrishna? He is a great yogi. He is a Dakshineshwar. So both of them started. And then they bypassed the Dakshineshwar, went beyond Dakshineshwar, from Calcutta to Dakshineshwar, and they went beyond Dakshineshwar. At that time, Dakshineshwar was almost in a jungle. Nowadays, all the greenery has gone. At that time, it was not to be seen from the road. They missed it. By the time they realized their mistake, they had gone far away. Then it was noon past when they returned back. Both of them were very, very much tired. And what happened to Yajneshwar, we don't know. But Kali was tired. He could not walk back. And he had no money to travel by any other conveyance. So he went to the Dakshineshwar temple. There he started weeping. He was hungry on one side, exhausted on another side, and without money to return. It was past midday. Then he hears that the Paramahamsa, whom he wanted to meet, is not at Dakshineshwar. He had gone away to Calcutta and was returning only in the night. So this was, that was just past midday. So what to do when he was in a predicament like that? Another young man comes, and he was luckily the Shashi, the Shashi Maharaj, Swami Ramakrishna and later on. So he was also waiting for Sri Ramakrishna to come in the night. He had also left his parents and came to meet Sri Ramakrishna. He met this young man. He said, "Oh, I am also waiting for him. So you just now, don't worry, don't weep. You need not return now. You stay here till the night." So he was taken to Kali temple. Then he took prasad there, had bath also earlier in the Ganges. Then they were waiting for Sri Ramakrishna to come. So Kali told Shashi, "But I have not informed my parents, they will be very much worried." Then Shashi consoled him, "I have also not informed my parents. We are both of us in the same boat, don't worry." So they consoled one another. Both of them were waiting for Sri Ramakrishna to come. And Sri Ramakrishna came in the night. It was almost past 9 or 10. Then Kali was waiting near the room of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna, as soon as he got down, he uttered the name of Mother Kali 3 times, Kali, Kali, Kali. Then Kali Prasad thought, "It is a very good sign that he is taking my name." As soon as he gets down 3 times, then he straight went to him and asked him, "Sir, can you please teach me yoga?" This young boy of 16 asking Sri Ramakrishna straight away at night 10 o'clock, "Can you please teach me yoga?" Sri Ramakrishna looked at him. So the master of the studying the personality in depth of anyone, he immediately said, "Certainly, I will teach you yoga. You were a yogi in your previous birth. This is your last birth. So you have come here. I will teach you yoga, but not now. At 10 o'clock, come tomorrow early morning at 3:30 a.m. So Kali did not sleep at all in the night. He could not sleep for the excitement that he would be initiated into yoga by such a great Paramahamsa. Then Sri Ramakrishna called Kali and then made him sit on his seat in the northern veranda. We all remember that northern veranda was the place where Swami Vivekananda also was advised by Sri Ramakrishna many times on many secrets of spiritual life. Then Sri Ramakrishna wrote a mantra on the tongue of Kali and he went into deep meditation. Kali went into deep meditation. As soon as he received this mantra written on his tongue, then Sri Ramakrishna tells him, "Meditate morning and meditate in the night and tell me any visions you will have. And don't marry." The first instruction for the would-be yogi, don't marry. So Sri Ramakrishna asked him now and then about any divine visions you had. So once Kali reported to him, "Yes sir, I saw Krishna, Christ, Chaitanya all merge into yourself. I saw a vision like this." Then Sri Ramakrishna immediately said, "Right, you have seen Vaikuntha. You will have no more visions like forms like this. That now you will have formless meditation." Thereafter, Kali started meditating on the formless God, the God with form he started with. Now he ascended to a higher level, progressed level, and started meditating on the formless God. So once Sri Ramakrishna, Kali realizes that Sri Ramakrishna is the soul of all. How did he realize? There is an interesting incident. Sri Ramakrishna had the throat pain in the last one year of his life, he suffered very much from the pain in the throat due to cancer. All of us know it in the history of Sri Ramakrishna. So everybody used to suggest some medicine or nothing. So Golapma suggested to Sri Ramakrishna, there is a Dr. Durga Charan of Calcutta, a Ayurvedic doctor. He can give very good medicine for your throat trouble. Let us go to him. Then this young man Kali and Latu and Golapma all went with Sri Ramakrishna to Calcutta. So the work was finished. Then he gave some medicine. Taking the medicine, all of them were coming back by a boat. Suddenly, Sri Ramakrishna felt very hungry. So I am feeling very hungry. Please bring me some sweets. Let the boat be anchored and then someone go purchase some sweets and bring. So Kali brought the sweet from the bazaar, then got into the boat. The boat started going and crossing Ganga to come to the Dakshineshwar. And all were hungry. They had all gone early without eating anything. It was almost noon when they were returning. All the Golap was hungry, Kali was also hungry, Latu was also hungry, and Sri Ramakrishna certainly was hungry. He asked for the sweets, but to their astonishment, Sri Ramakrishna ate away all the sweets that were brought by himself, and then took some Ganges water, and then drank, and then was very happy, fully satisfied, and free from hunger. But all were astonished. So how did he do it without sharing at least some with us? But to their astonishment, they found, as soon as Sri Ramakrishna was fully satisfied and started smiling and talking to them, they found all their stomachs filled, all their hunger gone, as if they have taken full breakfast along with him. Then Kali understood that Sri Ramakrishna is the soul of all souls. If anyone eats, it is equivalent to eating himself. So through his mouth, he has yet eaten for all. When he is satisfied, the whole universe is satisfied. Tasmin tushte jagat tushtam preedite preeditam jagat. About God it is said, if he is pleased, whole world is pleased. So if he is satisfied, whole world is satisfied. So that is how Kali learned the great lesson that Sri Ramakrishna is an ordinary person. He is the soul of all. He is the indwelling God himself. Then Sri Ramakrishna gave one day 12 ochre robes, one of his disciples. So he brought some 12 ochre robes to be distributed among good spiritual people, holy people. Then Sri Ramakrishna said, where can you get more holy people than these youngsters who have come to me to become the future sannyasins of this order, a new order? So he took those 12 ochre robes and distributed among the young people. One of these young persons was Kali himself. And then they were asked to go and beg food. Right now they have taken their ochre robes, go out and beg food from the society as other sannyasins do. So these young fellows went out. What they did was, first they went to Holy Mother Sharda Devi, who was living next to Sri Ramakrishna. And then they went and begged, stood before her, and then uttered the usual prayer, Annapurne Mahapurne Shankara Pranavallabhe Jnana Vairagya Siddhyartham Bhiksham Dehi Cha Parvati. O Parvati, you give us the bhiksha, the food, this food of the Jnana Bhakti, Jnana and Bhakti. So mother was very much pleased and gave them as a token of her full approval of their sannyasa vows. She gave her one full rupee, and that was the first bhiksha they had. Everyone was very much pleased. Sri Ramakrishna was also very much pleased. Then the Shivaratri came. Shivaratri of March 1886. Sri Ramakrishna was at that time in the last part of his life. Only a few months he is going to be alive in the physical body. So on that Shivaratri day, Narendra and Kali were meditating side by side. Then Narendra told Kali, so you touch my knees. So both of them were sitting, squatting and meditating. So Kali touched his knees and he found he felt like getting a shock, mild electric shock from Narendra's body. Some electric current is being passed into his body. He felt that. Then after some time, Narendra said, all right, you remove your hand. How did you feel? Then Kali afterwards, when he sat for meditation, he went into deep meditation. And that was the meditation on Advaita, that losing one's own self in the Supreme Godhead, Brahman, Aham Brahmasmi, to realize the great state that I and Brahman are one. So he was meditating in that Advaitic way, deeply. In the meanwhile, Sri Ramakrishna came to know that Sri Narendra has tested his power of transmission of his ideas into others. So he called Narendra and scolded him. Why did you pass your ideas into him? This is, you have yet to accumulate the power, number one. Number two, you should know to whom you are imparting. He was proceeding in a different way. He was not meditating as you do on Advaita. He was meditating in a different way, which I know. Why did you pass your idea of meditation or your meditation into him? He just admonished him. Then Narendra also knew his mistake. Then anyway, Sri Ramakrishna himself assured, no much harm has been done. The boy is lucky. Then he made the correction. Then Swami Abhidananda was the same old self again. Then Sri Ramakrishna passes away. Then all the youngsters, they take sannyas in a ritualistic way. And Swami, the Kali Prasad becomes Swami Abhedananda. So Abhedananda is a monastic name of Kali Prasad Chandra. That was in 1886. So the MUT, what we call as today Ramakrishna MUT admission, it was started in a haunted house at Varaha Nagara, which is called Varanagar. So Varanagar MUT was started, and then Kali Prasad, as we have already known, he was a great scholar in Sanskrit. So he used to spend much of his time in tapasya, in japa, prayer, meditation, studies. Japa, prayer, meditation, studies. So always he would be much, no food, nothing. He would not ask for any food at all. He had to be dragged out from his room and then made to eat something by other brother disciples. So he was called the Kali Tapasvi, the austere Kali. See, with that austerity continued all his life. With a great scholar, scholar of death, he would forget his body itself when we go deep into studies. So he wrote many Sanskrit hymns on Sri Ramakrishna, on Holy Mother, and on other philosophical topics. So one of the beautiful poems he wrote about Holy Mother was Prakritim Paramam Abhayam Varadam Nararupadharam Janatapaharam, etc., etc. Praising Holy Mother as you are the supreme Prakriti, the power of Brahman, and you have come here taking incarnation as to bless all the people, humanity. So this poem, he went to Holy Mother's place. She was staying in Nilambar Babu's garden at that time. Then this young man went and then recited his own written poem to her. Mother was very, very pleased and then just blessed him. May Saraswati ever reside in your tongue. And it literally happened. Later on, we see in the history of the Ramakrishna Math Mission, Swami Vivekananda goes to West and preaches for full 4 years, both Europe and America. He revolutionized the thought current of the Europe and America. So after that work, if anyone had continued the Vedantic teaching in the West, it was Swami Abhedananda to the longest period of 25 years. Swami Vivekananda preached for 4 years. Then many of another two disciples were sent, two brother disciples were sent. And earlier to them, Abhedananda had gone to London to meet Swami Vivekananda there from 96 to almost to 1896 to 1920, he was in the West with one or two visits to India, short visits. So he preached Vedanta for 25 long years in the West. So when he went to London, as I already said, and after 1 year spending 1 year in London, he went over to New York and USA, and he impressed all by his good appearance. Appearance of Swami Abhedananda was very impressive. He looked almost like Vivekananda, only a little leaner, and so he was much younger to Swami Vivekananda, younger by 3.5 years, and the people there appreciated him very much, and depth of his scholarship and eloquence, he impressed everyone. In 1899, Abhedananda initiated some Westerners into what we call the Brahmacharya oaths of lifelong celibacy. One of them later on became a great Swami of our order. And in 1906, that means after almost 10 years of his stay in the West, he visited India. And this year is important to us who are in Chennai, because at that time he laid the foundation of this new campus. Swami Ramakrishnanandaji Shashi Maharaj was running this Ramakrishna Mission Center at the Ice House for the 10 years, and the new venue was, the site was bought, site was donated by one of his friends, Kondaya Chettiar, and on this new campus, the foundation stone was laid when Swami Abhedananda came here in 1906. So afterwards he went to Bangalore, there also he laid the foundation stone for the Bangalore Ashrama. Then he reaches Calcutta, and then after some time he goes back to USA. So when he went back, he took another one young Swami with him. That is a different story. He was a great administrator. So he goes and organizes many things which were to be organized on a strong footing. Then he leaves for London in 1909, where he met many scholarly persons. Along with that one great Frank Dvorak, a Czech artist, famous Czech artist. So after discussing with Swami Abhedananda and knowing about the greatness of Sri Ramakrishna and Holy Mother, the Frank Dvorak paints Sri Ramakrishna and Holy Mother, the painting is very unique. It is there in the ashrama, later on founded by Swami Abhedananda at Darjeeling. I have been there, I have seen those pictures, they are very good. Then he also, when at that time he had to return from London back to USA, so he wanted to return by a boat. That boat was to leave on the next day or the next day. He had gone to book a ticket there, but he could not book, because he heard a voice saying, don't book the ticket, So he was simply astonished. Who is telling? There was none. Then he found that a second time again. So he was advised not to purchase the ticket. Then he just gave up the attempt, came back. He later on heard that that boat by which he was to return, for which he was trying to book a seat, had been torpedoed by the Germans. On the next day, more than almost near 2,000 people had died. So he was in tears and praying to Thakur, "Oh Lord, you have yourself uttered those words. Otherwise, who else was there to advise me not to purchase the ticket?" So that was the great experience he had. Like that, you know, he had many spiritual experiences. Then, so we come almost to the last part of his life. He came to India in 1920, after 25 years of preaching Vedanta in the West. So when he came, so he attended on 14th January 1938, the temple dedication ceremony of Belur Math. Belur Math, you know, Swami Vivekananda had prepared a great plan for Sri Ramakrishna's temple in a unique way. Sri Ramakrishna, he said, was a unique avatar who just he personified inside himself all religious ideas, all spiritual ideas, all ideas of all incarnations. So he was a person of synthesis. So his temple also should be a synthesis of all the world architectures, the architectures of Europe, architecture of the Mohammedan period, and then architecture patterns of the North India, South India, all these to be combined and made a unique temple for Sri Ramakrishna. So it took quite a lot of time. Swami Vivekananda was not in the mortal body. So he gave this idea in 1902 or so. Then this temple was ready by 1938. That was inaugurated by Swami Vijnanandaji. Only two direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, monastic disciples, were living. One was Vijnanandaji, another was Abhedanandaji. So Abhedanandaji attended that function, and that was almost the last. Then in September 8th of 1939, Swami Abhedanandaji, who was 73 years old, almost a little less than 73 years, 3.5 years younger than Swami Vivekananda. So he passed away very peacefully, and so many Swamis who have met him, so they gave wonderful impressions of him. I had the opportunity of meeting one Swami, Swami Antaratmananda, Krishna Maharaj. So he was a disciple of Swami Vijnanananda. So he, as a brahmachari, he belonged to Kerala state. So he went to Belur Math to take Diksha from his guru. So he went to, and when he was staying in Belur Math, he heard that Swami Abhedanandji, for his own reasons, he had started another ashram for himself in Calcutta, Raja Raj Krishna Road, and he used to stay there and lecture about. Then this Swami, this young man, wanted to see Swami Abhedananda. So this Krishna Maharaj or Antaratmananda, later on he became a monk. So this young man, Krishna Maharaj, went and then found that the Raja Raj Krishna Road, nobody is there, because Swami Abhedananda was alone, and perhaps one or two assistants were there, some brahmacharis who they were busy with somewhere else. And Antaratmananda moved out here and there, and we did not know where to meet Swami Abhedananda. Then after wandering, he found one room was open somewhere with a parda, with a curtain. Then this young man went and then just moved the parda without announcing himself. If anybody were inside, then they should know that he is entering. Simply he moved the curtain one side, just entered the room and found Swami Abhedananda there. He had come from outside And he was just completely undressed, and he was to wear the normal dress inside the ashram. When you go out for lectures, naturally he would have gone with the sannyasin's full dress. And then inside the ashram he would not wear all that. So he had removed the earlier dress, and he was about to wear the dress. At that juncture, this young fellow has gone inside. So Bhavidanaji was rather little perplexed. So he just told him, "What is this? You don't know any etiquette. You just entered my room without announcing." Then Krishna Maharaj, this young man, he just kept quiet for 2 or 3 minutes. Then he said, "May I ask you one question, sir?" Then Abhidhanji was rather perplexed and rather angry, I should say. Then, "All right, ask, what do you want to ask?" "Sir, you have all seen Sri Ramakrishna without any class like this." So he never objected to anything. "So why do you object to my seeing you without class?" Then immediately when he said Sri Ramakrishna's name, Abhidhanaji's all anger went away. He started smiling at him. "You are right, all that, you have done well." Then he put on his dress and everything became normal. So that was the great persons, these direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna. With only another one incident, I will close. Another one great Swami, Swami Niramayananda, who was a great scholar, this Swami, who was a disciple of Swami Akhandanandaji, with whom I could stay for several years, 4 or 5 years, and he used to tell many of his great reminiscences with the direct disciples. One of the reminiscences with Swami Abhedananda was very interesting. He once went to Swami Abhedananda. He was a monk at that time. So he asked Swami Abhedananda, "Swamiji, I have read in Kathopanishad that the Atman is there in every one of us, which is eternal, which is never born, which never dies, which is full of infinite knowledge, infinite bliss. So, is that Atman is there? Is it true? I have read, I am reading it, but I am not convinced that his Atman is there inside me and inside everyone. I am not getting that full feeling that I am that Atman." Then, you know, Abhidhanaji looked at him, then said, "Suppose I say that Atman is there, it is existing, will you believe?" "Yes, sir, because you are a knower of Brahman, you have been trained by Sri Ramakrishna, and we all know that you have experienced this Atman in you. If you say, I will believe." Then Abhidhanaji said, "Yes, Atman is there." As soon as he heard this, Swami Niramayananda tells me, my doubts went away. My whole life, that doubt never came back. That is exactly what happens when a man of knowledge teaches from his full knowledge the same thing. It just impresses you and gives you the correct knowledge. A man who has known Atman, who had realized Atman, when he said, "Atman is there," this young Swami immediately got the full faith that Atman is there. So these are the great people. So that Sri Ramakrishna left behind him, Swami Abhedananda is one of the gems he left behind him to teach the world what real spirituality was, what real harmony of religions was, what real experience of God was. These were all living examples of spirituality. We are today lucky to reminisce some of the incident in his life. May Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swami Vivekananda and Swami Abhedananda bless us all. Jai Ramakrishna. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.